the love that I feel during the dark times. You know what I mean?
Hey, listen, I invited you back on.
Thank you so much.
That's love right there. I mean, you're probably going to get you a print of yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, that Percocet's going to go over real big.
Real big. That's okay. You can handle it. You're a big boy. But we're mixing it up today a little bit. We're bringing some of the guests that we had in the past on, and I could not pass up to ask Coach Ben to come back on. Because it's been weeks since you've been on here. You've had a lot of stuff going on.
I do. A lot of things going on. First of all, I had my right knee replaced, which, listen, I had 5 knee surgeries back when I was playing. They'd say, oh, you're out 5 weeks. I'm like, bullshit, I'll be back in 3. You're out 10 weeks. I'm like, no, I'll be back in 7. This one, I said, you'll be good in 4. I'm like, no, it's going to be 1 week. This thing is killing me. I got range of motion back in it and all the things you're supposed to do. But man, this thing hurts worse than all of the other 5 put together.
Especially the physical therapy that you have to do where you're going to push down.
Well, listen, I've been through physical therapy for 30 years while I was playing. That's a given. You know that that's going to hurt. You know that you have to do it. And it hurts. Make no mistake, it hurts. This one is like, oh, by the way, you're not 28 anymore. So let's throw the hurt and the ache in there just to let you know that you're not a whippersnapper.
Yeah. I'm lucky. I haven't had that. My wife had told me to do surgery, so I know what you're going through.
Well, a lot of people will say afterwards, oh, it's the greatest thing in the world. Tell me that in your first 3 weeks, I will call you a liar and smack you with a mackerel. There is zero chance that anybody else has felt good after a couple of weeks of this thing. It takes a while, and it ain't pretty, but the light at the end of the tunnel hopefully is not a train coming by way.
Words of experience right here. It'll be good.
It's a very deeply introspective.
It'll be good. It'll be good. It'll be good. You'll be able to walk.
Happy birthday to Carla. Happy birthday to Carla. Carla is one of many of our season ticket holders, frequenters of the Fish on Fire experience up here.
Happy birthday, Carla.
It's her 21st.
Sure, I know. Hey, but Ben, you know, a lot of stuff has gone down in the last couple of weeks. We've had the Albany team coming in here.
Sure.
Ron and Nate versus the Albany team.
Which, right.
Name will be announced in the near future, I'm sure. But then we just had Baltimore out now. They're not in, correct?
You know, I don't really know the ins and outs. Our ownership would probably have to address that. Funny you should mention Albany. Because I understand that the ownership in Albany is paying really, really well. So in addition to having my name in the hat for Orlando, which at this point really hasn't been looking that good, I dropped my name in the hat for Albany because those dudes up there are paying. And, you know, listen, arena football is arena football, whether it's here in Orlando or whether it's up in Albany, New York. We're all just going to have a good time.
Yeah. They know you're injured right now. Do the people in Albany know that you're injured?
Listen, I'm coming off the IR in 6 weeks. I got plenty of time to get ready for the season.
You say 6, they say 10. You just, you know, live with it. You'll make it.
Tomato, tomato, potato, cucumber. Who knows?
Exactly. But, let's see, we had the commissioner on.
The commish! Chris Siegfried.
2 weeks ago, yeah, 2 weeks ago we had the commissioner on. And we threw some questions at him as far as, like, the fans want to know. I want to know your perspective on it. Fans want the Nets back. What are your thoughts on having the Nets come back?
You know, there's good and bad. The Nets were part of the original systems, and it adds a lot of excitement to the game. Not having the Nets behind on either side of the uprights, it's one of those things where if you kick it through, you get 2 points, you start back. You know, there's some strategy there. I personally like the Nets because that goes back to old-time arena football. But bigger than that, the problem with the Nets or the benefit of the Nets, I was coaching a team in Milwaukee my very first year. We got the ball first. We had to kick a long field goal. They scored a touchdown. We didn't touch the ball again until the second quarter. They got five balls in a row off the net. So we were down 35 to nothing before we got the ball back. You know, so anything can happen with those nets. But, you know, it's neither here nor there. And a lot of it, I think, in my opinion, has to do with player safety. Players don't have to turn their backs on eight guys running down trying to kill them. And you know, you catch that thing and turn around. It's like Jumanji. You have no idea what's coming at you. So.
That's that, you know what? When we had Ricky Walls on, he was saying, hey, that's, you love that part. You only had to worry about five of the guys because you know his team would take care of
them. Ricky, he lied about liking the Nets. Ricky was so terrified of getting hit. If he could have stayed in the stands and danced, I give Ricky a bad time. He's a great player and a great guy. And once he got going forward, if we picked up a few blocks, boy, he would fly through and he'd get down there and dance like nobody's business because he was pretty good at it. Now, if there were people in front of him, Ricky was, what's the guy's name? David Copperfield. He could make an elephant disappear in the middle of a crowded room.
So he would disappear as he'd defenders in front of it trying to get
it. Yeah, listen. But he did it gracefully, though. Give him credit. And what was that you were asking about me putting my name in the hat for Albany? Yes. From what I understand, the Albany owners, boy, they are really open in the purse strings up there because they want things to be done right. So I, because I care about the goodness of the game, have put my hat in the ring in Albany. Still love Orlando. Really do. Mean it sincerely. Oh, hey, Ron. What's up? Great to see you. Sorry. One of the owners is here.
Yes, one of the owners is here tonight. The others should be here as well. So
he's turned into his new South Fork Ranch. He got himself new digs out there. It's beautiful. Really, really pretty.
Yeah, out there in Astatuta.
I don't know.
It's Lake County.
I just know it's Lake County.
It's going to be prettier when they get everything done. And you'll be moved in. And hopefully we'll have an opening party for it. Hey, listen, if you guys have a question for Coach Ben Bennett, call it in. The number's going to be on the screen in just a second, but I'll throw it out there. 407-595-1179. Ask head coach of the Orlando Predators at the period here at this time. Albany could be later on. We'll find out. But if you have any questions for Coach Ben Bennett, give us a call.
Or if they want to talk to me directly, they can call my pay-per-view lines. 1-900-BIG-STUD. Feel free to call as many times as you like. Regular text of great supply.
So that's the sets that you're taking?
Yeah, it should be. I got a whole bottle of goodness waiting at the house I haven't touched yet, but get closer.
Mark Raleigh's been coming out there. He says it's tough here on Facebook. Did you see that IT? Just make sure you can see it on there. I don't know how the feedback is for on Facebook Live.
Listen, I got Berkey to turn his head. If Burke turns his head, that means everybody in the building can hear me.
That's in the building. I want to make sure people out there, the fans out in Facebook land, can hear you as well. Ben, what about Iron Man? That was brought up to the commissioner as well. What are your thoughts on Iron Man?
Well, again, it's like the Nets. There's pros and cons to either way. The Iron Man game was how the game originated. What you did was you had a bunch of guys that played in the NFL, the USFL, the Canadian League, that were very position specific. You had a DB, and that's all he did was he played DB. You had a wide receiver, and that's all he did. You had a guard, and that's all. Well, what arena football opened up for a lot of people was the Barry Wagners of the world. The guy who, at the NFL level, is probably not fast enough to run by a lot of people on the outside at wide receiver. He wasn't quite big enough that he could do damage at a tight end position, but he was just a great football player. And you put him on the field and give him the ball or put the ball somewhere near him, he's going to make things happen. And so that's what happened. You would get the guy that was a really good pass rusher who, for one series of quarter, could turn around and pass for 10. And the substitution rules is what really gave him a bite. Because you say, okay, in theory, I'm going to start my best offensive two-way player, let him play one series on offense. Then my best defensive player at the two-way position, he's going to play defense, and then maybe offense. Well, if you had a longer drive, you take that guy out, you stick him back in, Now all of a sudden there's a turnover, there's an injury, there's this, that, and the other. And because of the substitution rules, that same dude has to play the rest of the quarter.
Right.
And if somebody gets hurt, that same guy has to play the rest of the game. And I mean offense, defense, and special teams. That's why they coined it the Iron Man, because those dudes never left the field.
And the fans won that back. I mean, that would just wear somebody out to where I personally don't want the Iron Man to come back, because I like fast pace, everybody's fresh, offense in, defense in, and, you know, swap players out. Iron Man kind of nulls that, doesn't it?
And, you know, yes and no, but you're talking about a different type of player. The guy that will play and happily play both ways for almost an entire game, that's a dude who wants to be on the field, and he's going to press his rear end to make sure things happen. Now, when the Arena League went away from the Iron Man rules, was when the NFL started flexing their muscles and said, we want to be involved. Well, that's great. Give us money, give us support, then you can start changing it. We had Ron Jaworski come in, we had all of these grand plans to be an NFL subsidiary, and the NFL never did anything. And so now we went from the guys that were playing both ways and all the substitution rules. It was just back to it's an outdoor game, but it's played indoors. So the arena football purists would like to have Iron Man back. I would love to have Iron Man back. But however they lay it out, we're going to go out, we're going to win games, we're going to have a lot of fun, so I don't really care either way.
Oh, that, yeah. Now, I noticed on TV, or on TV, I noticed on Facebook and on Twitter, Instagram, everything, you know, all these other different social media things that other teams are signing players already. The so-and-so has been re-signed, so-and-so has been re-signed. What can you tell us about some of the players that we had signed for the 2020 season going into the 2021?
Well, the majority of the guys want to come back, but now that there's a run-on expansion, some guys, there's a team that's closer to home. And if they want to go, I'm not going to stop them. There's guys that might get paid. And if I can't fault the guy for wanting to go somewhere, we're paying him $200-$250 a week, and he can get $500 somewhere else or $1,000. Go, I'll drive you there. I have no problem with that. But the guys that we have talked to, the guys that I've talked to that were in the nucleus, the majority of them have intimated that they want to come back. Now, in theory, we should have a bunch of people that want to come back. In reality, we got to get them signed. So we'll see.
So we got a lot of players that we have players inside wanting to come back.
A bunch, yeah.
Good. That's always a plus. I mean, honestly, the amount of players now, the name, the recognition of being, you know, arena football, best team to play for. Last year was that great. I know. I see.
Well, I can guarantee you this. If there was a player on our team last year that you really enjoyed watching play, we'll get him back. All of the things that we started last year, we'll finish this year. All of the traditions, all of the pomp and circumstance, they will return.
I love it. Except for the negativity, we don't want that in coming back from last season.
Listen, right now we're in the middle of, we're third week in August, and we're not even going to camp for 7 months.
But hey, listen, you got to look into the future. I know. Try to get the comments, because I'm blocked in the comments again.
Alan Duckworth has a question for Ben.
What was the question?
Alan Duckworth wanted to know, what was the most devastating hit in your career?
This podcast is only 2 hours long. Well, I got to tell you, there's a couple that stand out. The first was my junior year at Duke against Carolina, who pretty much is scum. We hate Carolina. Carolina hates us. So we hadn't beaten them in 10 years. This was Spurrier's last game at Duke, although I was the only guy that knew it. We go out, we're playing the number 2 defense in the country. Third quarter, about second series, a guy named Mike Wilcher was first-round draft pick. He cheat shot late, and he knows he did. He hit me right in the ribs, and it froze my entire body up. And I was like, you gotta be kidding me. And I limped off, got the sideline, another kid came in, play to play. I said, no, I'm going back in. So I ran back out of there. About three it on the film. I threw it. The camera starts panning downfield, but you can see Wilcher coming around. He hit me again. Another cheap shot, and he cracked two of my ribs. So I go off to the sideline, and if you've ever had cracked ribs, imagine somebody putting an ice pick into your lungs every time you take a breath. Not even close to what that feels like. The emotion, the adrenaline, Carolina, Duke, my buddies, whole bit. I told a freshman, I said, give me your rib pad. And he's like, what? I said, take your stuff off right now. Give me your rib pad. I throw him back on, and as my trainer, who had just told me I was out of the game, he's going over to the van to get ice. I'm running back out of the field, pulling my shoulder pads on over these rib pads as he's screaming, no, no! So I go back out, we finish the game, we beat him 23-17, first time we beat him in 10 years. It took the better part of 6 weeks before that type of pain subsided. And cracked ribs is not something that I would wish on anybody. It was brutal. Now, besides the fact that I've been knocked out of concussed 13 times, so my senior year, we're playing Virginia Tech. Virginia Tech had a little-known defensive tackle named Bruce Smith. Bruce Smith, not a bad little country ball player, but nobody knew who he was. Well, second quarter, he gets me, knocks me, slap out. I thought I was in the huddle, and I was standing on the sidelines. I'm like, hey, like, how did I? Because I was literally just in the game, and I was in the huddle, and all of a sudden, I'm on the sidelines. Well, nobody knew I was knocked out. So I'm like, all right, so we come up with this plan to block Bruce Smith. We're going to help with this guy, and this guy's going to help a little bit. We get into the fourth quarter, and we're still in a pretty close ball game. We have this grand blocking scheme. Bruce Smith runs around the whole thing. And as I'm getting ready to throw it, I got hit in the back of the head. If you've ever seen the movie The Professional with Natalie Portman when she was little, when the bomb goes off and he gets shot in the back of the head, he just starts going like this, and everything turns yellow. Yeah, that was me. And I hit the deck. It was the hardest I've ever been hit. And for some stupid reason, the only thing I could think of was what my father had told me since I was a kid, which is don't ever let him see you hurt. Get up and go back to the huddle. So in my mind, I said, get up and go back to the huddle. My legs were like, zero chance of that. And I looked like a drunken sailor at 3 in the morning. My leg, some guy catches me and is holding me up and says, why don't you just wait here for your train? I said, that's a hell of an idea. Now, I didn't know until the next day. Started falling over, he's the one that caught me and said, wait for your train. And just, it told me a lot about the kid. First, that he was a tremendous player. But what a class act. He could have watched me fall, stood over me, done anything in the world. But for the second time in the day, he knocked me out. And instead of look, he held me up. So,
that's a class act.
Those are a couple of them.
That was from, that question was from Adam Claw. Top Trevor wants you to bring back LJ Castillo as a wide receiver.
LJ Castillo, he played with us a little bit in 2019, I think.
Yeah, last night.
LJ is he's a nice kid, and he's a really good receiver. But this league, as much as I'd like to keep a lot of guys around, this has become a young man's league. There's a lot of really, really young players that are just dying to get out there and prove themselves. And I think that's kind of the direction of the league.
Take drinking water.
No, I won't be drinking any water. I'm drinking cranberry juice.
It's good.
That's
good.
What I'm drinking.
Yeah.
And my girlfriend is Morgan Fairchild.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, there we go.
And one of my other business partner, Nate, just sent me a text and said, hey, let's sign some players. I'm like, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's sign a head coach.
I heard Rob King was available. I'm just saying, rumors get out there.
I'm a predator for life. good coach, man. He's won a lot of ball games. Very enthusiastic guy. And I wish he and Les Moth, I wish them both the best. people think about the game.
Exactly. I mean, it's nonstop excitement, and it's all over bowl seating for the season tickets. All over bowl, so you're right down here, right close to the action. You're not going to want to miss it.
Same procedure and same policies we've had over the years. If one of the footballs goes into the stands, you get to keep it. If one of the players goes into the stands, you have to give them back.
Which brings me to a comment I had. I did a guest spot there on CycleFeverTV over at Ace Cafe.
Right.
And shout out to CycleFeverTV for hosting us tonight here and giving us our lighting and our mics and everything here. But Jean B. Martin, and she is a front row season ticket holder since day one.
Right.
And she said how one time she caught herpes balls in her seat, and she did not want to. She kept hold of it, didn't want to let him go.
Well, herpes little enough, she probably could have carried him all in her purse.
She was didn't want to let him. She tossed it all back and wanted to keep herpes.
Herpes a good guy. He was a big part of what we did. He was a big part of the foundation that we laid towards, you know, being what we eventually became. You know, there's a lot of guys: Barry Wagner, Jerry Odom, Paul McGowan, Henry Brown, Wendy Burnett, you know, Billy Owens. You go down the line. There's just so many. Derwin Rockmore, Tony Scott, Carl Akins. There were just so many guys that put a lot of time and effort into making this franchise Orlando's favorite. And you can talk about the Magic, and they're fantastic, and they're an NBA team. We were a way harder thing to get way back then than the Magic.
I'm
going with it.
Yeah, I know it is. And
most of the stuff I say on here factually, I just made up. So if you actually research any of the quotes that I have, you'll probably find that I'm erroneous. But they sound really good, because what I do is when I tell you a fact, I will enunciate, I will speak louder, and I'll move my hands a lot. So even if it's not true, you will think that it's factual.
You see there, lesson learned, folks.
No, I'm sorry, no questions. Question of the day? Go ahead.
Do you have a question?
Kind of. I just looked up on here. You playing for the Cowboys?
Yep.
Bengals, Browns?
No. Cowboys? The Houston Oilers, which will tell you how old I am. The Atlanta Falcons, the Cowboys, the Bengals, and the Bears.
What's your coaching experience?
I've coached a little bit in the AFL, the AF2, and then I coached back at Duke for almost three seasons. So I've got a little bit of pro experience, a little bit of college experience. I can coach anywhere. I'm comfortable in the Arena League because I've done it for so long. The bigger plus for me is I got to call my own plays and put together my own personnel group for many, many years. So for me, this is just natural. It's just something I've done for a long time, and I feel really comfortable doing it. Plus, if I can do it in Orlando, all better.
There's no better place to coach.
Listen, I'm going to tell you, I was in Dallas before I got traded here. I had a head coach there named Ernie Stott my very first year. Ernie was a great coach. Said, go do what you do. We went to the Arena Bowl. We got beat by a team that brought in six NFL guys in the playoffs in Detroit. The following year, they brought in Drew Pearson. Drew Pearson is a wide receiver who knew nothing about the game. Told me to my face that I wasn't going to run his franchise because I wasn't his kind of player. You read between the lines. So I ended up getting traded to Orlando halfway through the season. And when I got here, we were staying in a part of town that I had to sleep below the window line so that the bullets flying through didn't hit me. And I said, there is zero chance I'm coming back to Orlando. Zero. My head coach is like, no. He goes, listen, the ownership here is great. People are great. He goes, at least listen to me. I said, they got one shot. So I came back, made me an offer. I said, all right, I'll give it a 1 year. Give me a second year option. And I've been here ever since. So Orlando is it's a great city. The people here are fantastic, as evidenced by most of the group here at Fish on Fire. And it's just, this is home for me. You know, whether I'm coaching somewhere else and coming back, I'll always call Orlando home.
And you'll always be a son of a friend. You can't say Orlando Predators without mentioning Ben Bennett in there.
Oh, and that's the way it should be, by golly.
I know. And I noticed that I read it somewhere that there's no conceit in your family.
No! That's it. It's all under one castle. freshman year do. It ain't bragging if you can do it. And I mean, and that's the truth. If you say, listen, I'm going to go out, I'm going to hit two home runs today, and you go out and hit two home runs, that ain't bragging. Yeah, the one where the cocky and the conceited really started sticking with me, growing up in California, we set all sorts of state scoring records in high school. I called all my own buddies. We kill everybody. I get to do. We go through the entire season, and I'm kind of doing the team thing as I always do. We got to an interview before the Carolina game, which was the last game of the year. Now, Carolina at this point is 9-1. They're ranked fourth in the country. The only team they lost that year was Oklahoma. So they're Lawrence Taylor. They had five guys in their front seven drafted the first two rounds of the NFL draft. So I go through this big, long interview, and at the very end, he goes, well, what are your personal goals? I said, well, first of all, I'd like to win the ACC at least a couple of times before I get out. I said, I'd like to be named ACC Player of the Year at least a couple of times. I said, I'd like to throw for over 9,000 yards. Now, at that point, Mark Herman still hadn't set the NCAA record of over 9,000 yards at that point. My last quote was, and personally, I'd like to destroy Carolina. Now, all of the hours worth of quotes about the team and I care about Duke and the conference and the whole bit, none of that went into the article. It all came down to, I want to throw for 9,000 yards and I want to beat the crap out of Carolina. So that went on the bulletin boards and that's where it was. And I wasn't about to back down from it because I said it and I admit it. Now, I saved all of the article from every person that wrote something about being cocky and conceited, this, that, and the other. As I hit the milestones that I said I would, and I was ACC Rookie of the Year, ACC Player of the Year twice, and I threw for six NCAA records, 15 ACC records, and 42 school records. As I reached every milestone, I would handwrite on the article, Love Ben, and I would mail it to the guy that wrote the article. So, Dizzy Dean says it best, it ain't bragging if you can do it.
You know what, that's great. That's great. I don't want to say slogan, but that's definitely a great thing to live by. It ain't bragging if you can do it. So you heard that, right? It ain't bragging if you can do it. I know, it doesn't stop. You still do. So let's see here. Kelly McCabe's got a birthday today. Kelly is out there. Actually, her birthday was on Wednesday. Happy belated birthday, Kelly. You're welcome. I know Phil's in the house because Phil's coming on later on. Dick Jukowski's in the house. He's going to come on the show in a minute. And so is Alan Claw. We'll be on the show.
Kelsky's here?
Today. I'm sorry?
When did you get out of the car?
Man. Look at his ankle.
Little blue light flashing on the bottom. I got it. It goes with the outfit though, Nick. Looks good on.
It's a release. But you folks out there, any more questions for Coach Ben Bennett? Please bring him in now. He's not leaving, but we're gonna bring somebody else that stays here in just a minute. Ben, you have anything else that you want to throw out here?
Let's see.
Come on, man, it ain't bragging if you can do it.
That's true. I just realized we didn't talk about the bottle of goodness. That's the oxy. Yeah, that was it. Different kind of bottle, but a bottle of goodness that I used. It just set in. Now, listen, we enjoy coming out here every Monday night. This place, if you haven't been here, it's an absolute blast. Bartenders and waitresses all take really good care of you. There's a nice little clientele that comes up. Make sure you wish Carla a happy birthday on your way out. She's the one over by the corner of the bar giving away her cookies. But it's a good place. Take care of the people here. They'll take care of you. Hope to see you guys back. I'm going to go see what Jakilski's work release program is about. And thanks for having me.
Thanks for having me, Coach. I really appreciate it.
Hey, wait. This is where the thunderous round of applause comes in.
Nice job.
That's what I'm talking about.
Nice job. Everybody give a hand to Coach Ben Bennett.
I'm a cripple up here doing this job with you guys.
You can't see it, but he's got this nice little scar on his knee from the total knee replacement.
You see the pain that I fight through for this team?
And he wants to go to Albany. He's not going to get any love in Albany like he does here in Orlando.
That cold weather is not good.
We play indoors.
Somebody out there said there's cold weather out there, Ben has to say. Play indoor football. That's how it works. I don't know. I'd Steve, do you have a, I'm going to throw it out there. Just going to do a little, throw on Facebook here. A clip for when we did, we had the Orlando Predator Brawlers on the show. We did a little dance number, and we're going to throw it to IT John right now. Take it away, IT.
Can't hear the music, but that's okay.
Like the league, you know, adding teams, it's definitely going to be better with 10 teams than it would have been if we only had 8 or 6. So there's definitely some positives that we can take from the situation. So that's how I'm looking at it. I think that the season and the league as a whole is going to be better from this.
I hope so. I mean, you say it gives us time to get in shape and then the snap and everything else, you know. But on a different twist of it, I happen to know, when I spoke with him today, one of our players from last season that was signed on for this season has a guy, he's got a tryout with the Miami Dolphins this weekend. So, I mean, good luck to him.
There's a lot of guys that play arena football that, you know, have the hope of using this as a stepping stone, and that's definitely one of the benefits of arena league is playing outside of the other seasons, so you get your footage out there for them to see.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, you get it out there to move up again, and what you love to do. I lost my pin here, and there it is. Just to remind everybody, all right, because since we first started doing Bread Talk, we've got more and more following us and you at each show. Tell us a little bit about yourself again. Just remind the fans, where are you from?
Originally, I'm from New Jersey. I grew up there my whole life. I moved to Florida at the beginning of 2017. I started kicking probably the summer before freshman year of high school. Basically taught myself off a magazine article from Adam Vinatieri that was in Sports Illustrated. And then I just loved it. I fell in love with that. I used to play wide receiver and cornerback, but those are the two most popular positions. So instead of, you know, having to compete with all these guys in high school, other than the senior kicker who had one more season before I graduated, I said, you know, hey, you know, there's nobody else going out for this, so I'm going to go for this spot. And then, you know, I stuck with that. And then I played the year of junior college afterwards, Lackawanna College, which is one of the best junior college programs in the country. Mark Duna, our head coach, is one of the most winningest coaches. You know, he played for the Cardinals back in the NFL. Those guys still are successful, but it was all D1 caliber guys that just either didn't have the grades or whatnot. They played a year or two there and they moved up. And then I played a little semi-pro football a couple of years in New Jersey before I went to. And then I would visit because my mom had lived here before I moved down. So I went to a couple of Predators games before I even lived in Florida, and you know, I fell in love with arena football. The first arena football game I ever went to was a Columbus game in Ohio. And this is early 2000s, and you know, that was the first time actually seeing an indoor football field. And I thought it was awesome because it's, you're so up close and personal, it's faster paced. And then once I moved here, you know, the Predators had already folded. And as soon as the news came out that they were starting back up again, I immediately started training again and then tried out. And I actually got to try out in front of Mark Lewis. He evaluated us, me and another kicker there at the tryouts, which I thought was awesome. Because, you know, Mark Lewis.
If you're a Predator fan, you know Mark Lewis.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I mean, a ton of other teams. I know he's played for other teams, but, you know, when you think of kicker for arena football, you think of Mark Lewis. So outside of football, I'm also a firefighter and an EMT. I've been doing that for 11 years now. And that's why I like playing here in Orlando, because I live here. It gives me the opportunity to still have my normal job and normal life, and then also play for the same community that I live in. So I really don't have any interest or to go anywhere else or play for anybody else. I'm a Predators fan before I was a player. I'm just going to say that.
That's good. I mean, I'm glad to have you back. I like you. You're nice. I say a nice kid. That's because I'm old. But yeah, you're a nice kid. You're always very polite. And you can get the shit out of football. That's the best part right there. Now, I haven't seen your mom on here following us in a while. Because your mom always would watch Carolyn, right?
Yep.
And I'm surprised I don't see her on right now because she should be up on here. Looking at her son.
No, I'm hoping we don't have any issues here.
What?
With the feet.
What did it say? Music. We got a music out there. Like, yeah, there's
still those shows are streaming now, so. But I heard you talking to Coach earlier about fans wanting to bring the Nets back. And me as a picker personally, I would love to have the Nets back. You know, I would love to have the Deuce and keep the Nets. I think if the combination of the two would just make the game keep that fast pace. And you know, because the Deuce, everybody loves the Deuce. It keeps the extra way to score. It gets the fans hyped. You know, everybody loves seeing the ball looking down right. But the only problem is if you miss it, they're basically at midfield and in arena football. Nine times out of ten, if you start at midfield, unless you force a turnover, they're going to score. So I like having the four balls because, like, you
what?
Four balls.
Sorry.
So when on kickoff and
you
the
did
ball.
Say bar balls, right?
Yep, bar balls. So kickoff and the bar goes off of the iron from the nets and bounces off the kickers. Everybody calls that a bar ball.
Okay.
And that's like.
Glad you clarified.
Yeah. That's even actually, in my opinion, and probably a bunch of other kickers, those are more valuable than deuces because you have the opportunity to either get the ball and score or get the ball and then have the offense come in and score and then score a touchdown as opposed to just 2 points.
Dickie almost put a comment on there. A comment, not a question. Dickie thinks I'm a server. He says, have Morgan make me some work to be there in 30 minutes. So, okay, there you go, Nikki. Morgan make Dickie some work. Okay.
Ordering in.
I didn't know I was the ordering in guy. But that's okay, that's alright. I'm gonna see you in store. Alright. Tammy, good question, Tammy. When is the online store going to be up and running? That is such a great question. I sound like the commissioner. That is a great question.
Never a bad question.
No. But I will tell you this. We're having a meeting tomorrow with a merchandising company that is going to try and fill all of our needs at the very lowest and cheapest price. Believe me, we want nothing more than to get merchandise and open up an online store so that you fans, Greg Myers, you can get your jersey, you can get all your stuff. Trust me, I've not forgotten about you folks. I hate bringing it up because it sounds like I'm saying the same thing over and over and over again. But we are working on it. Once we strike a deal with this company, once we put the order in, 14 days later we have it. So hopefully it'll be, before the end of September. All right? I mean, that's giving me a long goal, but it's not up to me. I'm the middleman here, guys. Please bear with me. And trust me, I'm going to tell you, I'm not being in line of credit. Speaking the truth. All right? I saw on Facebook that you were with the new sheriff elect over in, was it Volusia County?
Osceola.
In Osceola County, and he gave you a job. What was that? Was it you were like an honorary deputy?
No, so Marco Lopez won the primary. And so now obviously he has to go in the general election in November, which is one of their independent, but it's a Democratic county. Helping him with the election there. old school door knocking, sign waving. But yeah, Osceola County, I believe, has like 45 openings. And his thing is that when he gets in, he's looking for good guys to bring in, trying to fill those spots. So I definitely would love to make the switch to go and continue to do public safety, but kind of do something else. So I'm trying to find a way where I can still do fire things, but we'll see. That might be a lot. It's up and coming, you know. For the longest time, the IFL was really like the big league other than the AFL, and I think we're starting to see a shift now. The NAL is starting to come up, and I really like kind of the way the NAL, the daily operations are, game day operations. You know, it's a new league, so obviously there was just some stuff to fix here and there, but I mean, the commissioner and our owners are. I mean, as well as, you know, Rob Storm and the other owners.
You know how you do it? Rob Storm's asking to show up tonight. That's all right.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of the Shark Tank, but Rob Storm, he's a good owner. These guys, unlike maybe some of these other leagues, these fly-by-night leagues that pop up and fold, these guys are, they have the commitment, you know, they want to be involved in football and not just own a football team. They want to make sure the league survives, which is great. And you know, as a player, you want to know that if you're playing for a league, you're playing for a team, there's security of, you know, you don't want to be in a league that's going to fold halfway through the season. So, and so knowing Ron and Nate personally, it's hard to not comment on social media because I might know some things that haven't been released yet. I see all the comments, I'm like, I want to answer, but I'm like, no, it's better. I'll just wait for that to let the surprise happen. But Albany is great. Albany has a great following, it always has. It's one of those venues and markets like Orlando and Tampa and Jacksonville.
Interesting about
that is the NAL now has three champions? Yeah, you have Albany, who won the championship in the AFL.
Albany.
You have the Rough Riders who won the championship in the AAL, and then you have our champions, and they're all in the same league. So now you have three top teams all in the same league now, which is awesome.
We have a lot of talent. A lot of talent coming into the NAL. Not just different teams, but a lot of different players that are coming in. Because the AFL folded, so these players still want to play. They still want to move up. They still want to, you know, compete. And that's what it's all about.
Absolutely.
And there's no better place than to come into the NAL. It's, especially for the East Coast. You know, especially on East Coast. You know, there's a lot of different things out there on Facebook, and I'll bring it up. I'm not scared. I'll bring it up. I know the Massachusetts Pirates went to the IFL. And that's pretty much West Coast. In the West Coast. I personally think they're making a mistake. But hey, listen, that's
just It's always going to be hard.
On paper, it doesn't look feasible. But hey, look, more power to them, good luck to them. I think once they're about to come back to the NBA now, because we're not going anywhere.
Oh, I believe it.
We're not doing
it. I wouldn't be surprised if before this season or before the season following, if we are up to 12 teams with the amount of things going on in the background. You know, I know the ownership of Baltimore canceled out, but I still think Baltimore still has potential in the future for a different team. You know, and I've heard, right now I'm not going to name any names, but I've heard of at least two other areas where they're right now in discussion of bringing in teams. So, you know, in a matter of less than a year, we could possibly, you know, go from, you know, a handful of teams to 12. So.
Do you know something that we don't know? You want to
indulge? I don't know.
You want to give us some insight on something? You know?
No.
Because I've been out of town from Thursday to Tuesday. I was out of town. I didn't hear all this juicy gossip that maybe you got. Some different questions.
Okay.
You know that I ask new people on the show, and I give up some, like I said, some new questions, and they're silly questions. They're not to be serious. And if you could gain the ability to time travel, what's the first place you'd go to?
Oh man, there's so many.
And don't say Rachel's 2 weeks ago, all right? That's just not going to work.
There's so many things. Well,
you want to come back to it?
No. I would love to, I'm a big history guy, yeah. So I would love to see something very important in history. Now, are we able to interfere or just view something like that?
Listen, this is your fantasy. If you want to jump back in time and you want to stop Abraham Lincoln from getting shot, I mean, you know, that's your prerogative. This is your little bigger thing. It's just my question.
Maybe go back to, like, go meet, like, George Washington himself.
To meet George Washington?
Back in the 1700s.
I gotta tell you, ever since that was the hardest bullet to get that answer out of you.
There's so many places. You can go back and see the Big Bang. You can go back and meet Jesus. You can... So many different people and things to do.
Meet George Washington. Good for you. I do have another one here. If you could wake up tomorrow with a new ability, what would you want that ability to be?
Probably invisibility.
Somebody else said that.
Yeah.
And I don't know. All right, that's cool, but I don't know why.
As
you're a single man, you want to be invisible. I would love to be able to play piano.
Oh, well, you did say ability, not superpower. I was thinking superpower.
Oh, superpower, yeah.
I would love to play the piano, too. That was always an instrument, either that or like the guitar. But I think the piano is an instrument that I would love to play.
Yeah, because you can just walk through the mall and sometimes there's a piano and stuff.
You want to talk about getting a girl.
Guitar, you gotta find the guitar and listen to that piano. They're everywhere. They are everywhere. Lost my feet again. Now, let me ask you this here. What advice would you give a 10-year-old?
Oh, man. school and had more opportunities that way. But you know, I took a semester off and ended up never going back. So that's it. That's bad. Don't ever do that.
That's, yeah. IT.
I know. Give me a minute.
I'll
put it together.
Cool. Gotcha. Really, you're here. There you go. Get green here back live. So just so you can bring
it to green. You want to make an announcement? I didn't know we were.
I didn't know either.
Yeah, I didn't.
So apparently we were.
If you were watching the stream, you could keep watching it.
Oh, is that right?
If you closed it,
come
on.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. That's what I did. Listen, if you guys are walking around from table to table, to thank you again for coming and being on a show. Once again, I appreciate you.
Of course, John.
My next guest is going to be Phil the photographer.
Oh.
You see him on the field, he's running around in his bright yellow shirt. He is going to be coming on here and get to know Phil. You know, you see him out there, you can get to know him.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely one of the player's best friends. They always out there action shots and claim photos. He does a good job.
He does a fantastic job. That's your cue, Nick. That's your cue, Bill. Come on up to the stage.
Switching out here.
Good thing, sir.
This is PG-13.
PG-13? All right.
All right. Hey, listen. Bill, you get to talk into that microphone right there so the people can
sound check.
Hear it.
Good.
And everybody out there can hear it. As long as we're going to play jump on, we're going to get kicked off again. So we're all right with that. Somebody wants an Orlando competitor, Gator. Tell us a little bit about yourself as far as like where you're from.
Been in Orlando, Central Florida for 40 years now. Family moved up from South Florida in 79. I got started in professional photography in 2011. 9 years later, I probably shot about 400 different sporting events and about 150 arena football games. I've covered at least a half a dozen arena bowls. And it's a really hard business to survive in. Not too many people do it full time now.
So, what did you show me here? You showed me your Procon megapixel, large and small. What did you show me here?
So, a lot of people ask about megapixels in a camera. They market a higher megapixel thinking you're going to get a better quality picture, where I prefer a lower quality megapixel because you actually get more light into the sensor. This is first time I'm doing this on air, so work with me, guys.
Shutter speed.
Wow.
Shutter speed.
I'm going to go through a settings for arena football as an example. I'm going to say hum a lot.
That's okay. Hey, listen. I appreciate you coming on.
You're welcome.
I put Phil on the spot today at about, I think it was 5 o'clock, 4:30, 5 o'clock. I said, hey, Phil, I need some people for the show to come on the show. Just, you know, I don't want to say to build time because you know I love you and I talk to you every Monday when you're here. And by the way, people in the back, if you want to talk as loud as you want while Phil's up here, he's used to that. That's okay.
Payback's coming.
I appreciate you coming.
I explain to a lot of people that want to get into photography, all the cameras are basically the same. I tell the people to invest in glass, which we professionals call lenses. If you have a better quality lens, you're definitely going to get a better picture. A lot of the SLRs, they all shoot the same. The only difference is we get more frames per second on a pro camera versus a consumer grade camera. Entry point, I would say it'd be a $400-$500 camera. Jump up to a professional camera, you're up to, you know, anywhere from $3,500 up to $6,500 a camera.
Cameras ain't cheap. I know that, Derek, because I was in the pawn shop business years back, and we used to get, when I first started, it was just a 35 millimeter, not the 35 millimeter digital, it was just the film. And they're expensive back then. And then once they went into the digital part of it, they went skyrocketing. You made thousands of dollars for a lens. Not counting the lens. Now, what did you bring with us tonight?
What I brought is a 1DX Canon. I will hold it up. This is my second camera shooting. I have a 1DX Mark II. This is a 24 by 70 2.8 aperture lens. It's a really fast focus lens. A consumer lens would be recommended as an f4 aperture. The cost is going to be a lot less. I did not bring my 70 to 200 tonight, but if someone wants a good wildlife camera, I would recommend a 70 by 200 f4. You're probably looking at a $900 lens, and I would put that $900 lens on a $300 or $400 SLR camera, and you're going to get the same quality.
So, listen, how long have you been shooting? No, wait a minute, we're crazy. How long have you been shooting? footage for the Orlando Predators?
Last year was my first year that I came on board with the organization. I have shot Orlando Predators, AFL, with the league, or for a media outlet.
Okay. So, but as far as your company, your business, is it Hot Shots?
We have the link. It's hotshotsstudio.com. There's actually galleries on there for arena football. It's a great sport. It's fast action. I shoot also college football. And it's just a different game being indoors. I've only been partially injured once in an arena football game shooting because we are allowed on the other side of the wall to shoot. So there was,
which is a danger zone.
This
can be
the story I have about the danger zone. Tampa 3 years ago, Orlando's playing at Tampa. I'm actually shooting with the Tampa Storm photographer Scott Audet, and we heard the whistle blow in the end zone. We're looking at our pictures, and one player from the Orlando Predators decided to give a Tampa Storm Predator, Tampa Bay Storm, a cheap shot. And not paying attention during reviewing, I got sandwiched between two 300-pound guys. So that was an interesting evening.
I bet. Now, Carolyn, you just jumped on. Yes, you did miss your son. You missed Nick tonight, but that's okay. We're going to be re-editing and splicing together because we did get Facebook slapped us on the ass about playing Welcome to the Jungle. So Ronnie Harbison says it's our photographer. Absolutely.
Thank you, Ronnie. Look forward to next season.
But yeah, Carolyn, it'll be out there. You can see it. You can see it. Believe me. Can't see it. If you know my number, text me, call me, and I'll make sure that you get to see the interview. So, Bill, did you get into photography because you couldn't play sports, or did you play any sports when you were in school?
If band counts.
So what instruments do you play?
Percussion.
Okay, so you drum?
Yep, from 6th grade until 11th grade, played quads in marching band. And my senior year, I said, you know what, it's time to see how the other side enjoys life. And that's what I did my senior year. But, 7 years, 8 years in band, it was time for retirement.
Yeah. I mean, you're not wrong, man.
No, it was great. A lot of great experiences. Band camp is band camp.
Is that true what they say in the movie about the band camp?
Being a freshman was really brutal. Going to band camp. I couldn't even imagine the seniors getting away with what we had to endure.
Yeah.
And I'm going to show my age. This was back in 1981.
Is that when you were a band?
I was a freshman.
Video shoots, weddings, everything else, mitzvahs, everything. To give us a list of what you get out. I'm trying to get you as
gotcha.
Out here for you.
No videos. I do some drone footage, but it's mostly stills. We have done some video production before for products and a photo studio. But it's pandemic going on right now, it's basically a very stagnant business. People think their cell phones are all that. They're great for videos, but if they're trying to capture a professional image, a cell phone will not get there.
Right. I mean, hey, I have an iPhone 10 Max, whatever. It takes great pictures, but nothing compared to what you get right there.
Yeah, when you're looking at this for your camera versus this for a camera, there's going to be a little bit of a difference in quality.
A little bit of a difference in quality. I mean, the cost is probably close to the same.
Well, the new phones are, I mean, these new phones are, what, $1,400?
I know, it's ridiculous.
Who would ever thought they would be paying $1,400 for a cell phone?
For a cell phone. Well, you're paying for a computer. A handheld computer.
I agree.
You're paying for it. And that's what I do as well. I was going to say here, a couple silly questions, but then I want to roll along here.
Got it.
Someone was a little long-winded earlier. hey, listen, throwing a show together real quick. I think it's going along really well. Let's see. What is your opinion about what's been going on over the last couple of weeks with the NHL? I mean, what did you think of the announcement that the owners of the Atlanta Predators purchased the Albany team up in New York?
Actually, very impressed because what I've seen from the ownership from last year to this year, it's night and day. Nate has always had a passion that I saw last year, just getting to know Nate. And with Ron coming on board, just, you know, it's unfortunate we couldn't have a season this year, but I think the pieces will be in better place.
Oh, yeah.
For next year, I think it's going to be better organized. But yeah, I cannot wait to get back into the jungle, into Amway.
And just to throw this out there, you know, about Nate and Ron, this is Ron's first season as an owner of a football team, professional football team. He's been in business, I don't know how long, a long time. He's very successful. It's huge. Nate has been, this is his second year as an owner of a team. So these guys are new into it, but they are also, they're business smart. So they're, it's not going to be like the 2019 season to where...
Did we have a 2019 season?
Yeah. Nothing against... He's a great player, not a very good businessman. I mean, that's all I'm going to say about that. But now it's all about business. It's all about the fans. It's not about them. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, and I have... Ron is here every Monday night to support me here on Red Talk. So, you know, he doesn't have to come, but he does. He doesn't tell me how to run the show. You know, he lets me do my thing here.
But he should.
I know. Keep it rolling. IT John says, keep it rolling, man. I'm going to be editing all night.
Well, I've actually been a Predator fan since 92, 93.
Yeah.
And had season tickets. And everyone misses the old Amway. You know, that was just the perfect arena for arena football.
The TD Waterhouse,
the Orlando Arena. Lot of amazing memories.
Yeah.
You know, I proposed to my first, which became my ex, at one of the games.
Why do you say first? Has there been one?
No, there will only be one.
Okay.
I will never, as they say, never say never.
You can say never.
Yeah, I will say never. Get married again.
Yeah.
I will go on books and say that. Even Kelly would even agree with me. Correct, Kelly? Kelly cannot hear me.
He said happy birthday, Kelly.
Happy birthday, Kelly. You know what? Come on up, Kelly. Come on up, Kelly.
Ron.
Yeah, come on. Come on up on Phil's show. Come on.
Come on. Come on.
Come on, Kelly. It's your birthday. Get on Red Talk real quick.
This girl's so amazing. We met each other 3 years ago, and we're all gonna sing her happy birthday.
We have two birthdays in the house, too.
Who's the other one?
Carla at the bar.
How about Carla? Carla just had a birthday.
And Alan, yeah. Duckworth just had a birthday, too, just not. When was it? 2 days ago? The 20th. So, 4 days ago. My math sucks. 4 days ago. We're going to have Alan on the show here in just a minute.
Yep. So let's sing happy birthday to Kelly. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Kelly. Happy birthday to you. Hey, Max,
talk. Happy birthday, Carla and Kelly.
Morgan has a surprise for you.
and if she's gonna get pissed off and throw it at you, don't get another stuff.
There you go, sir. Make a wish.
No, he's still sitting there. It didn't come true.
No.
No. Skipper Knight.
Yes.
Okay, that's a first on Brett Talk.
I'm gonna let you go.
Don't tell us about Flash. You wanna bring up the Flash?
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize how valuable this is. It's a Flash. A lot of people should start using them during the daytime because your pictures are so much better. And I see a lot of people out there not using a Flash. So it's just something we actually use during the daytime, out in the sunlight, to actually get a good picture.
Yep. Why is that?
Why is that?
Because of ambient light.
Ambient light.
Okay. As video production knows, you light up something.
Yeah, you use a flash outside?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Your skies will actually be blue instead of white. A lot of people take pictures outside because they got to turn up the aperture and the ISO and they blow their sky out. And when you add a flash during the daytime, you can actually adjust that and actually have a beautiful blue sky if that's what you have in your background.
That's, I never knew that. I figure, okay, the lighting outside is perfect, it's good enough, you're not worried about it. But then again, I should know if you take a picture on your iPhone, it makes a different choice to different things to do. So, my phone is smaller than I am.
And a fifth grader.
Yeah, right. I don't know, fifth graders are pretty smart. Hey, listen, I ask people this too. If you had a new ability, tomorrow morning you woke up, you had a new ability to do whatever or this and that. You heard me ask earlier, or were you talking? What would yours be? If you had a new ability, mine. I would have the ability to play piano.
The ability would be, as I was a percussionist, to actually perform in front of 100,000+ people in a concert.
Okay, that's not an ability, that's a dream.
That's a dream.
That's an
ability.
You know, I mean, yeah, something you can't do now, an ability. Alan.
Wow.
2 minutes.
An ability. Help me, Kelly.
So you can do your ability? That's okay.
Yeah, I'm just brain farting on it.
That's okay. That's okay. Yeah. I
do so much now. Avid scuba diver. Actually, in class right now to get certified to teach scuba. You know, with the underwater photography I also have as a hobby. Offshore fishing is my huge passion. Also shooting underwater photography.
Those are some amazing pictures.
Thank you.
I tell you what, if you want to see some great pictures, go on the film's Facebook page. Look at them. They're amazing underwater shots. Did you swim with the sharks? Maybe the sharks?
I have swam with sharks in Mexico, bull sharks at 90 feet of water.
Yeah?
No cage.
So you did have some brain damage on that cheap shot from that. That's crazy. Bull sharks are supposed to be the most aggressive sharks, correct?
Yes, and tigers, but I have friends that run charters down in South Florida. They go out every day out of Jupiter, and they actually take people to go shark diving, and no cage, and they actually hand feed them.
Yeah, that's insane.
But they're an amazing creature. They've been here for ever.
Oh, yeah.
Millions of years.
When we're swimming in the ocean, we're swimming in their house.
That is correct. I haven't seen a shark yet. I haven't seen a shark yet walk up on land and bite someone.
No. I enjoy looking through your catalog. I say catalog. A lot of different things that you're doing. I know you're out there. You're always doing something exciting all the time. You're not working, cutting down trees and whatnot. Not so exciting. But then you're out there on a boat, you're out there deep sea fishing, you're diving with sharks, and you're on the field taking enjoy them, you know. If not, then you're just going to be always looking over your shoulder. You're just going to be negative, negative, negative. Be positive.
I got a lot of that out of my life 4 years ago.
Yeah.
Yes. And there's some, and there's some more getting out of my life. But you know what? Like I tell everyone during this pandemic, take care of yourself first. Make sure yourself is safe.
Without a doubt.
And if everyone would follow that rule,
that's true.
I think everyone could live in some sort of harmony.
Claw came into the arena on a horse. one game, which was crazy. We had 725 horsepower drag bike that I rode.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
We had race cars. We had done a video with us, and we had Paul come in the race cars. So I mean, we've done everything from side cars to 4x4s, all kinds of stuff. It's just been fun.
Let me ask you, and I know the answer, but how long have you been?
I'm still cool, so.
Say, how long have you been? I didn't say when you stopped being.
I would say about 26 years.
26 years.
Yeah.
Man, that's amazing. I mean, I hope you got another 26 in you, but hey, you
don't
know.
Tell my wife that. She'd be very upset.
Why?
Yeah.
She doesn't love the car.
She does. Don't get me wrong. She's very tolerant. But she doesn't think I can go another 20 some odd years.
I don't think I can go another 26 years. But, I mean, as far as I know, because I've asked the different players, and I've asked the newer people,
well, I've done so many different things as Claude, and so many of them can affect you in a lot of ways. A lot of the appearances I've done for charity benefits, we tried to put some money together for a young person who needed a wheelchair, for instance. I've done appearances for unfortunate families that have terminally ill children, anything out there, juvenile diabetes. I fought one round with a ninja at a karate tournament, to help out. So I mean, anything that they want.
In a costume? In your costume?
In my costume. Yes.
Oh my God.
Yes, and the fix was in, of course. I would. I look good doing it, though.
There you go.
That was the trick. I had to look good doing it. But, all of the things that I've done in one way or another have enriched my life as a person and as a mascot. I mean, I've never had any really horrible experiences in costume. They've all been very, very positive. After all these years, you would think I'd have like one real horror story.
You would think, I mean, because you've been doing it 20-some years, and you're not just on the field, coming out at the beginning of the game, you're out in the stands, walking around, mingling, being a part of the experience for the fans. And they turn around and they see you standing there,
That was the thing. I promised myself I was not going to be like, and I hate to make it sound this way, but I wasn't going to be like an NFL mascot. He spent most of his time sitting in the end zone. I just wasn't going to do that. I wanted to be in the stands with the fans and trying to show them as great a time as I possibly could.
And you, I'll tell you what, I've been to different arenas, and I've been to the NAL, and back then the AML. To a couple games that were out of town, and there is nobody that comes close to what you do as far as fan experience, for the competitors, for the fans. And I mean, it's amazing what you do, and your enthusiasm still after 27 years to do what you do is just it's amazing.
It really boils down to just being fun. I mean, if it wasn't fun, I wouldn't do it. We've had one particular experience, and I don't know if I mentioned this last time I was here. We were at an arena in San Jose. So all the mascots for the league were invited to this. And we had an event where we had to go to the hospital to go see some kids. And our wrangler, I don't remember her name, but she had, it was like herding cats with all these mascots. She came to me, pulled me to the side, and said, "I'm going to let you come in last. Because that start bouncing into the room, and all of a sudden, some children started screaming and crying. And then I show up. I immediately went over to a table and started talking to a young kid who was coloring, going to get the little motorcycle. So I started talking to him, and I drew him a picture of a motorcycle. I drew a cartoon of him on it, and I was fine. Our handler, on the other hand, was stunned. And all my other buddies over there were really jealous and upset because I was here talking to the kids and having a good time, and all they could do was mock.
And 8 Nick Tchaikovsky. I want to thank Phil, the photographer. Thank you for coming in.
Who's around?